And good late night evening to everybody out there in internet television-y land. Hello, I want to welcome you to an incredibly special data mine. We usually do this Thursday at 1 p.m., but we decided to add a very extra episode just for the man who you see over to this side of me. This is David Serlin, and we're going to go through everyone present, but go ahead, take a moment and introduce yourself.
Oh, introduce myself. So I am a game developer and I've worked in video games as well as tabletop games. I was the lead designer of Street Fighter HD Remix and Puzzle Fighter HD Remix. And now I run my own company, Serlin Games, where I've released several tabletop games, including Yomi, Puzzle Strike, and Dante. I wrote the book Playing to Win, which is about competitive games. I don't
You
know. I don't
you've
know if
not been
that's.
busy at all. You
Yeah.
really haven't. As you can tell from the screen, we do have someone who you're used to seeing, but he's in a very dark light right now with a very shiny, baldish head. Patrick is joining us, and he is from Elysian Shadows. And we also have joining us from the MMO Buff team, Peter, who is one of our streamers, but also a massive fan of Balance and has opinions on it that mirror David's in some respect, and we're going to spend our time getting to know the man behind the Serlin. If that actually makes any sense. So let's start off with one of our random questions, which we love to ask people. And I purposely am picking this question because I think I know what the answer is going to be, but we'll find out. So if you could only play one game for the rest of your life, what game would it be? And why?
Yeah, I don't know. That's a tough one. I guess the first game that comes to mind is maybe the fighting game Guilty Gear. It's just so complicated. There's so much to it that you get into it for a long time. And the other game that comes to mind is my own game called Codex, which I've been developing for years and years, and I play that more than just about any other game. But those are the top two that I think of.
So you definitely like your table games.
Why do you say that? Because I
Well,
chose one?
yeah, of course.
But I don't really play many. That's one of them, though. I play
Okay.
mostly video games. I don't know.
You play mostly video games. Excellent. Okay. Well, what we're going to do now is we're going to dig into the real big part of the show, which is what really inspired me to get in touch with you. Here at MMO Buff, we have quite a few shows, and every single show, it makes a difference whether we're talking a 4X strategy or an MMO or an RTS or a turn-based strategy game. It makes no difference. The concept of balance comes up, and everyone thinks they've got the answer. Everyone thinks, and we've had a huge debate about this. Some of our viewers have actually said everyone should be exactly the right balance. We argue for asymmetrical balance in games. Now, I think, considering what I read from your particular website, there is this fantastic piece. And Peter, if you want to do me a favor and throw it out to the chat, because if no one has read it, because he's changed his website, so the link address has changed.
Yeah, I
So.
just relaunched my website. It's completely different looking than it ever has been. A lot more
Should
streamlined
be
and updated.
this article.
It's clearer to find things. It definitely is. I like it, but then again, I also do web design, so I look at it from the perspective of is it user friendly? And it is. So, except all the links that you had are now in different locations, so it's a little bit of a hunt and find thing. But
Well, there's
going.
that beautiful articles page. It has a nice thumbnail of all the articles,
Yep.
so you
Yes.
can find it
That's what I'm using to find it.
Yes, absolutely.
There we go.
But
Game Balance and Yomi, which is linked
yes.
in the chat.
Now, what struck me about this is the fact that you understand that not everything needs to be quote unquote perfectly balanced. It doesn't even need to be rock, paper, scissor balance either. There's a deeper, richer methodology behind balance. So, do you believe in asymmetric balance for all games or just for certain types of games?
What is asymmetric balance? I mean, do I
Asymmetric
think that?
balance is different. It's where you don't have it. So like every character, every class, or every individual species is all able to do the same amount of either damage or the same amount of attacks, etc.
Well, maybe you're asking like, do I just like asymmetric games? Like, I mean, without the
Possibly.
word balance. I mean, I'm not sure if that's what you're asking, but if it is, my answer to that is in my, as a player, for me, just about any game is more interesting with asymmetric sides, like pretty much across the board. When you have different sides that can do different things, you get a whole bundle of cool stuff that you don't get in a symmetric game. So you get a bunch of different play styles. You get different personalities of those sides, and they could match your own personality. Like if you are more of a rushdown person or more of a tricky person or whatever, you can try to find the side in an asymmetric game that like lines up with your personal skills that you like. You get a whole bunch of different matchups that you wouldn't otherwise have. Like one way to understand that particular point. I mean, do we all know Street Fighter basically? So imagine if, or think about a match of like Ryu who throws fireballs against Zangief who doesn't throw fireballs but tries to get in and tries to do a powerful throw when you get close. That's the dynamic of that match, is trying to get close while the other guy wants to keep you away. Mm-hmm. Now, not all the matchups are like that, but that one particular one is like that. Now imagine a symmetric Street Fighter where everybody has all the moves. That's no longer a dynamic in the game. Because there is no, like, there's no Zangief that doesn't have a fireball. Everyone has a fireball. There's no keep out, get in thing anymore. Like, that's that one particular dynamic, you just lost it. And, you know, you could go through that for 100 other dynamics of matchups that you would have lost. So there's just this lot more richness and variety of gameplay you get from asymmetry. And then I'll give one more pitch for it. If you imagine like how much you have to know to play a game, you know, the more complex the game is, the more you'd have to know to play it. And we'll say you need to know X amount of stuff to play some certain symmetric game. Mm-hmm. Now imagine the asymmetric version of that. It lets learn the same amount of X, okay, but tune it so that you only really know one character once you've learned that X. And you can now play the asymmetric game. You don't have to know how to play 10 characters or something. That's very uncommon. So even though you only learned the same amount in both games, you can play both games. The asymmetric one is a much more full experience because it has all these different matchups and other people are experiencing totally different corners of the game. So it's kind of a trick to have a much more complex game without forcing you to learn all of it. So I like that property too. I like all sorts of properties of asymmetric games.
Yeah, that tends to be where I stand with things. So in your version of game design, because you've now been involved in quite a few game developments, what do you believe balance really narrows down to? What is the concept of balance?
Yeah, so I've written about that in a four-part series on my site, but I think the very first thing to talk about there is the word being a little overloaded and meaning more than one thing. So if you had a symmetric game, people could say that they didn't think it was balanced. But what would that mean? Because if we had, like, if someone said, I don't think some version of Street Fighter is balanced, they might mean that a certain character was too good or something. But people use that same word when there aren't even any characters. So I think that there's these two big categories. One of them I call like viable options, and you would need that in even a symmetric game. Even when everyone has all the same stuff, if there's some options or strategies in the game that are just useless and garbage and no one can use them, that feels imbalanced in a sense. It feels like something went wrong with the tuning of that system. So every competitive game there is needs to care about that type of balance. Like if you're going to offer several paths in the game that they're all usable, and they don't need to be exactly the same usable. Like if you're making a first person shooter and you could go around the map and pick up different weapons, there's no requirement or something that every weapon be exactly as useful as every other weapon. Because some could be harder to get or whatever, or, you know, there's a lot of variables where it could be okay to have different power levels there. But if there were some weapons that were just never used, that would feel imbalanced. Or if there was one weapon that was the only one you could really, like, nothing matters but this one weapon, that would feel imbalanced. So viable options is one concept. But then the different concept is the fairness of the options you're locked into when you start the game. like picking a character in Street Fighter or a race in StarCraft, those really do have to be equal or as close as you can get them. Like if, I mean, if you pick Zangief and someone picks Ryu and it's like you only have a 10% chance of winning, well, that actually is imbalanced. I mean, there's an expectation of fairness that at the beginning of the game, it's fair, that it's as close as possible to even. Now, how close is okay and acceptable, that's a whole other thing we could get into.
We can definitely get into that one.
There's a distinction there of like, in the one case, you're trying to make it fair, whereas just to make all the options viable, like in the weapons example, it's a different standard of balance.
What about the concepts where you have players who are really, really good at playing a particular character and players who are not necessarily so good at playing it, and yet they still have, you know, people will still say, oh, this is either imbalanced or it's unfair or it's been designed wrong because, you know, obviously this character is never being played anymore because they always lose, but it tends to be the players who aren't necessarily gifted who are interested in that playstyle. Because like you said, you can psychologically attach to a playstyle. So let's say I psychologically attach myself to a panda. Ah, I wonder where I got that inspiration from. But let's say I attach myself to that, and yet I am not good at playing it, and not everyone who plays it is exceptional at it. How do developers decide, well, it's the skill of the player that's actually at fault here, not our design? Is there a way to make that judgment call? Or are there even metrics you can use to figure something out like that?
I'm probably going to surprise you with a lot of these answers. I feel like I'm just guessing, but I think the picture in your head of what I do is way different than what I really do.
Interesting. Well, I know that you are heavily involved in a lot of different things, so...
I'm not putting words in your mouth because I'm just imagining what you're thinking. I don't actually know what you're thinking, but I'm picturing that you think it's a lot to do with mathematical analysis. And I mean, I have a degree in math from MIT, so it's not like I don't know this stuff or something, but I find it not very useful.
And, really?
Yeah. The main tool I use is talking to experts. That's almost my only tool, is talking to experts. If I talk to the best players of the game, and they tell me that the panda character is fine and has even matches, then I believe that. And they can back that up by playing each other and demonstrating that what they're saying is correct by showing that they have even matches versus each other. And then the next question would be, well, why are all these other people terrible at it? And we could unravel that. And I would ask the experts again. I would say, why don't you guys watch the bad players and see what they're doing wrong? It could be, you know, it could be something really surface level, like the character just looks so appealing that everyone who's new plays them, and there isn't any mystery or something. But a lot of the times it's something about, like, there's a weird thing about the character that you've got to know or else they suck. Like a counterintuitive, screwy thing you've got to do for them, although all the experts do, but that nobody who's new to the game would know how to do that. And that's kind of bad. Like, if that's what you find... You know, why not let the experts, or sorry, why not let the beginners play a more intuitive game? Like, let's change this thing around so it's just more obvious that you're supposed to play it a certain way. But yeah, many of my answers are going to be talking with experts or being an expert myself. So like in Street Fighter, I was an expert, and you know, I could make my own claim about this character is too good or not good or something, and I could back it up by playing the best players and winning or whatever. Mm-hmm. That's not the case in many of my other games where I am not one of the best players and don't even attempt to be. And so in those, I lie on people who are.
It's interesting. Raging Biscuit from chat just brought up something rather interesting because, you know, you're talking about relying on experts, and this is, you have to find your experts first and then you've got to trust them. And Raging Biscuit says, you know, you could put the best players on Panda. They might lie to you because they actually don't want to have their OP Panda changed.
Right.
So obviously you need to have that level of trust built in with whoever it is you're talking to.
Yeah. I mean, I get that. I don't know how to respond to that. Like if I'm, if I were reading like worldofwarcraft.com and seeing someone complain about the mage class or something, then yeah, that might be a factor. But when I'm talking about like these testers who I work with closely for months or years or something, I mean, I know what they're thinking. I know their real opinions. It's too hard for them to maintain some fake opinion like that. And they don't even want to, because they're actually the ones I'm getting the best info on. They're on the same team. I mean, the win for them is that like the game is good, not that the panda's the best or something. Right. The thing that's more common is that, okay, of course, nothing's perfectly balanced, like literally 100% perfect. It's always, you know, a little bit off. What happens constantly in my community is when something is just barely off by a microscopic amount, people complain an incredible amount about it and blow it out of proportion. So if the panda was like too good, I do not have the problem of someone going like, no, the panda's okay, don't change it. What I have is like threads full of people complaining the panda is like 1,000 times too good, when maybe it's like barely too good or something. Everything's magnified in complaints. So I don't have
this
the problem.
This is true.
I've just really never had the problem that person said.
So do you disregard metrics completely, or do you have some sort like, because like from what I've heard, you said that you pretty much don't care about metrics, but are there any that you still pay attention to? What I'm referring to, one of the games I played quite a lot recently was Hearthstone card game. And there were a couple of matchups which would feel close, like the game would feel alright, like you almost win, but if you would look at the win rate, it was like 80% lose rate. Like, you know, despite the matchup feeling good, despite like, you know, you thought that you almost had this hand lock, you almost beat your opponent, it was shown by statistics that you would like 80% of the time you would lose with specific decks. So and it's, you know, it's hard to pick up, I think, like even for pros, because like there is maybe because Hearthstone was a new game, maybe that, but we have a lot of pros complaining about certain cards, while we just had to wait a bit and wait for the meta to shift and for the players to react to come up with the solutions, while as there was cries for the nerf outright. So I think like that's what you want to say.
So what metrics do you use, if any?
A quick note on Hearthstone. So you don't, there's, you know, two modes in that game, the arena mode and the other mode. And in the other mode, players do not have equal access to cards. Like there's a collectible barrier. And so it's not an even play field. And so it offends me and I'm disgusted by it and I avoid it. Okay, but I can still answer your question. So about the metrics, again, they're just really not as useful as you'd think. I can elaborate more on why. So one example would be the character Gloria in Yomi. She's a healing character, and that's a very difficult... That's one of the most difficult types of things to do, is make healing work. But she is complicated to play. She's probably the most complicated. If we looked at the win rates for her, I'll tell you right now, she's probably the lowest, or close to it. But that's not because she's bad. It's because she's hard to play and most people suck at her. So if I did look at these statistics, like none of it's going to be even, and it's all going to be digging through like why is she so low? But it's like if I have to look at the metrics and then explain why they're all wrong or something, I can just explain why they're all wrong without even looking at them.
Because one thing about using a lot of metrics is that you have to factor in the skill level of the player. The only metrics that matter ultimately is where you've got an equal skilled player against another equally skilled player in that relevant matchup. If you've got one guy who's very good with one character but another guy isn't very good with that character, you're not going to get a fair reading on the matchup.
Mm-mm. Yeah, let me... So
Hold on 1 second. Go ahead, David.
I'm notorious for this, don't worry. You have... you should go first. Sorry, I'm notorious for
that. I was going to build on that point. Yeah, that's very correct, is that we only care about if both people are the same skill level and also high skill level. Another reason that the metrics are not useful, this is a double-edged sword. This shows how they are useful and not useful depending on your situation. I think I quoted this in the Game Balance and Yomi article. I can't remember that, but some exact numbers about like if a particular matchup was, let's say, 7-3, like if two experts played 10 games, one side would win 7, the other would win 3, and that, let's say that's the truth. Like, we're trying to discover the truth. That is the truth. We don't know it yet. And let's also say that we thought that was bad or something. Then how many games would they have to play for you to get to that truth? You know, I mean, if they play one game or something, like, well, that doesn't tell you anything. Like, what if they play 10? What if they play 20 or something? So you can, I mean, there's an exact math answer to that question. Of like, if you played X times, you would know with Y percent confidence, whatever the thing was. And when you do, when you look at those confidence numbers of like how much you'd have to play, if the truth of the matter was the match was 5-5, perfectly even, and you only played 20 games, I don't remember the number off the top of my head, but there's something like a 20% chance.
14%, I think.
Okay, 14% chance.
I think is the article says.
Yeah, you know what I'm referring to. There's like a 14% chance that the data would show you that there's like a huge problem and you should change it. But actually, in our example, there is no problem. So that 20 is not sufficient. And there's hundreds of matchups. So now think about having hundreds of matchups where 20 games amongst experts. How do you find these experts, by the way, the best players at each of these characters, getting them to play 20 of every matchup? And then when you do all that, it's not the same. And then 2 seconds later, you change the game. We change this number here and that number here and this constant balancing process. That's the killer right there. That is the reason why the stats are bad, is when a game is changing a lot. If we change stuff about the balance, then it's like all those stats are out the window and they can never accumulate enough data to get good confidence numbers. But at the same time, the players have really good intuition. Like if we change the stats, they can zero in super quickly on what exactly that changed in that match and what the new dynamic is. And after maybe 2 games, they could have a very high confidence level of, I think the match has changed in this way, if they're really good. So I can get to the answer way quicker that way. The flip side, and the reason why analysis, real math analysis, can be good, is if your game didn't change. Like, what if it didn't change for 10 years? Well, then you've got plenty of time to accumulate super high confidence levels. And yeah, you're going to have to cull out like all the people that are bad skill level or not equal to each other or whatever, but you'd have some hope of getting to a good answer. And like, I think Blizzard is able to do that. Like, I haven't followed like Hearthstone balance, but I did used to follow Warcraft 3, and they would have, or Starcraft 2. They have like just mountains of data on each patch. Like on this particular patch, you know, it was played 1 billion times or whatever. And here's the difference between the highest ranked Koreans and everybody else in the world. And I think they
break it through the regions. So, you know, not only the ranks, but also geographical regions. So
yeah,
you can have different metas in different parts of the world simply because players play differently. And that's something really amazing. So
I think Koreans are just better, basically. But
I mean, that's another thing. Like Koreans rule. That's true. But you know, I would say that Europeans and Americans are pretty equal. But still, there are some. There are, I think, like 2% win rates between last time I checked between Zerg and Protoss, and they're skewed towards Protoss in Europe and they're skewed towards Zerg in America. If I remember correctly, I may be totally wrong, but like there was some matchup that was inverted in those two continents, and I think like that's really interesting.
Yeah, so my kind of final point on that is that because in the process of balancing Yomi, we changed the balance like 100 times, 1,000 times, I don't know, constantly changing, I can get really good answers by talking to experts like in a day, that if I relied on the data, it would be giving me stuff that's like 30% wrong because I don't have enough data, like all the time. It would be way more than 30% wrong because there's no way they're going to play 20, like I patch it and they play hundreds of matchups times 20 games. Like, it's unthinkable. It's so many games.
Yeah, I think, what's it, at the moment, because with Sayomi, with there being 20 characters, that's 190 non-mirror. So to get 20 games of each is 3,800 games. That's a lot of games to play just to get even basic testing data.
Yeah, 190 non-mirror matchups, that's right. Yeah, so intuition's good.
And all of them have to be as close to balanced as possible. That's a lot of testing you'd have to do anytime you made any changes.
Yeah, and now my question for you, you've been working on Yomi for how long?
Well, the first version was in 2004, so 10 years. I mean, it wasn't released until January of 2011, but it was years to get the system right and then more years to balance it.
When did you, even though you've graduated from MIT, kind of decide the metrics really just aren't cutting it?
I guess I was predisposed to think that always or something. Because, I mean, growing up as a player, if I wanted to know who the best, what the character balance of the version of Street Fighter was that I was playing, I would just obviously ask the top three people in the country. And whatever they would say carried more weight than anything anyone else could possibly produce. So, I just always kind of thought that. It's just like, became more knowledgeable about why as time went on. And here's another interesting trivia about this concept of analysis not helping as much as you'd think, is that I gave a lecture at the Game Developers Conference, I forget what year, was it 2009 or something, and there's a handout on my site, a four-page handout that you can see what I gave the audience. And I'm going to tell you something I told them that day, which is kind of weird and funny. So, hey, everybody out there at GDC, I'm the third person at GDC to tell you the following message. I'm the third person. The message is that analysis doesn't help you very much in these competitive games, and intuition does. The two people before me who had exactly the same point in their lectures were Rob Pardo, who's the VP of game design at Blizzard, and Jamie Griesmeier, who was the head of Halo 2, a multiplayer team. They both gave lectures saying that exact same thing. So I feel like I'm in good company. Making a point.
Yeah.
Just a little bit. Do you have, by the way, can you grab that link for me, Peter, of that lovely handout?
See if I can find it.
I love making him work.
So one way, I think I mentioned this in
game
one
balance
of our
handout. Episodes. There it is, yes.
One way you can have the intuition about that stuff is that, think about Chun-Li's walk speed in Street Fighter. It's faster than other characters.
Yeah.
So how good is that? Like, could you give me some equation that shows her walk speed versus the priority that should be on her medium punch? Like, that, it's like unthinkable. Like, how would you ever relate those variables? But they are related.
Correlation.
They are related. The faster you can walk, the better that move becomes, you know, because you can walk in and poke with it really quick. So it, to know how much that is related, you just have to watch the best players. I don't know. Rob Pardo said the same kind of thing. He's like, when we make StarCraft, you can look at all these numbers and everything, but there's so many intangibles. Like, there's so many things about, like, if I select these Zerglings and send them to this base, what kind of pathing do they have where they get stuck along the way? Like, that affects how good Zerglings are. And when you talk to experts who play Zerg, like, that's factored in. And when you do only math analysis on how much damage Zerglings deal over time or something, it's like that gets lost. And that's one of a thousand things that gets lost. It's not just the pathing.
Yeah, micro is a king, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so many different things and so many small intangible things, particularly in RTS, that can make all the difference. You know, even just the little things like how quickly any unit switches target when you tell it to. If it's like that and it's instant and everything just suddenly bam, focus fires and things start melting. But if something, for whatever reason, due to a little AI glitch, it takes a fraction of a second to change, that can, particularly at sort of, you know, the very, very high levels, that can be the difference between winning or losing a fight.
Yeah, Cypher, it sounded like
very, very, very important.
But they relied on experts too. And like I said before, once it settles down, then the math analysis becomes more and more relevant about what where the chips fell.
Well, I throw out Cypher also. Cypher 007 points out from the chat, at least in references to RTS, are changes because of hardware upgrades and time management level caps, players finding bugs, real life problems. The list goes on and on and on and on. So, yeah.
Well, that's an interesting one as well, because haven't many things that have become accepted strategies in the years, particularly in fighting games, initially started as bugs and then sort of over time have become ingrained in the very sort of culture of fighting games themselves.
Definitely, that's it.
Yeah, that makes me think of K-Style from Guns. K-Style started out as a bug and it became a viable strategy, which they decided to implement in their next version of the game. Why leave it as a bug? Make it part of the features. It's obviously not a bug, it's a feature.
Same
very, for, very common in fighting games, yeah.
Tribes as well was another one, where the first game there was a bug where if you kind of kept hitting spacebar, you could sort of glitch the jump out and sort of skate across the landscape.
Yeah.
Every other game, every other Tribes game since then has just had a hold space to skate. Every other one since then, they just sort of went, this is actually really cool, emergent gameplay, and they just incorporated it into every other Tribes game since then.
Hmm.
And then you have something reverse when in StarCraft 1 you had overkill on units. So if you would target your blob with ranged units, let's say dragoons, and you would order it to shoot at unit, they would all shoot at it, and they would deal like 1,000 damage to a Zergling, which has 40 HP. While in StarCraft 2, they automatically deal enough damage to kill it, and then they shot run on like other unit, and I don't remember was it like random or some predefined, but they basically like as in like in StarCraft 1, part of the skill was to attack precisely and to precisely pick your targets and how many attacks you would have to on certain targets. That was part of the skill level. They completely neglected it and removed it from StarCraft 2. So you have people going the other way too.
Hmm. It all goes back and forth. And we're, just so you know, Sharp Object, we're talking about different types of balance. And we seem to have gone not just from the RPS version, rock, paper, scissors, to RTS, which is a little different. But yes, it's one of the things that, like, I honestly think David's right. Most of the time when I see people complaining about balance, more times than not, it's about the tiniest little thing. And sometimes it's actually about people who don't quite understand the trick of a character. There's got to be something hidden. I mean, you bring up your healing character and...
I hate playing against Gloria. I hate playing against her.
Yeah, why do you hate playing against her?
I play Arg.
Okay, fine.
So you put yourself at a disadvantage to start.
It's one of Arg's worst matchups because his trick is that as she heals, but his thing is that he's got a constant aura that ticks damage every turn. So she completely, yeah, so, as a base level, completely nullifies his main advantage.
So every other character inevitably dies after X turns, but not Gloria.
Gloria, because she keeps healing.
Yeah.
Have you ever won a game against Gloria?
No.
Okay. All right. Do you consider yourself an expert at Arg?
No. Oh, hell no. I'm terrible. Ironically, my best matchups that I play with Arg are some of Arg's worst, just not Gloria. I think about between a 60 to 70% win rate against Rook, which is a particularly hard matchup for him, because I think I play Arg completely wrong. so it just ends up working that way. But I love Arg. I love the feel of him. I love the style of him. I love the character and the personality of it. I'm just terrible at him.
Sharp Object points out, Alvarez, I am a bad Gloria player. I will play with you until you win if you like. Thanks.
The main thing is he's I think, themed around being a very defensive player. And whenever I seem to play him, I seem to go stupidly hyper-aggressive. And I don't know why, because I know I should block more. But I just can't resist, particularly against grappler characters like, say, Rook or Midori, or even Geiger to a degree. I love throwing out a high normal and then going straight into Bubblefish spikes, which is like his big super attack. It just does so much damage. I just love doing it, and it's really probably really really bad for. But it works really well against grapplers.
You can ask fantasystrike.com for some tips or something.
Turgid Bulk has a question for you, David. As a designer, what do you think of people using unintended bugs in a design? And what do you think of it from a playing to win perspective?
Well, of course you use bugs from a playing to win perspective. I mean, there's no two ways about it. There's no other side of that. There really isn't another side of that, because people are using bugs all the time without even knowing they're bugs. Like, how do you even know that half of these things are bugs? Like, I gave some examples in my article of some Iceman combo that uses a subtle bug that it just doesn't even cross their mind that that's a bug, but it kind of is. I mean, I don't think that if you interviewed the developers, I don't think they would have said they wanted this combo to work like that. So for that reason, it's like, You're now on a slippery slope of, well, okay, we've accepted those, but what about ones that we don't know what they think? Like, you shouldn't even be in the business of adjudicating that stuff. Just use what the game has. If the game has some bug that's terrible and ruins gameplay, hopefully that will be fixed. Or if it's possible to ban it or should be banned, that's another question. But that's not a question for you, the player. That's a question for the tournament organizer. So, yeah, you got to use them. So I used to help run Evolution, which is the biggest fighting game championship tournament in the US. And 1 year I wrote the intro or something to the program that they handed out to everyone. And I remember that it was it just lined up so perfectly the games that were played that year, that in my intro, I was like, today you're going to see all the best players do their stuff. And I'll tell you right now, you're going to see bugs in every single one of these games, and here's what they are. And like every single game had some kind of super powerful bug that a lot of competitive plays was based around. That year, they also had Mario Kart on DS, which is dominated by the snaking bug.
The snake bug, yeah. Where you continually sort of, if you pull it off right, you could just continue the power slide across the entire map, even on the straight. You could just keep continually
power sliding. What are you going to not do that? Because someone else is going to do it. There's no way, you can't even ban it, because there's no way to like exactly define snaking. What if they just barely snake? Does that count? Yeah, so of course that tournament was all about snaking, but every single other fighting game that was there that year, Capcom versus SNK2 was another one, which is dominated by the roll cancel bug. For those that don't know, in that game you can roll along the ground and become invulnerable, and then you can be thrown at the end or something. That's a normal game feature. The bug is that you can input the roll, and then one frame later input any move, any special move, and you get the invulnerability properties of the roll. So what it does is you can take every single move you can do and give yourself about 27 frames, almost half second, of total invulnerability. So everyone does it, because that's the best thing to do. And I don't know what to tell you. Was there more to the question than should you use bugs?
Well, see, that's the thing. You know, you talk about the tournament organizers, and you know, when you start to get into the tabletop games, you have the tournament organizers who ban certain cards in TCGs, who will say, you know, this card is definitely not a part of this tournament, etc. But you can't quite do that in a video game. I mean, what are you going to do? Implement some specific software to verify whether someone uses the invulnerability bug? It doesn't quite work that way.
I find it interesting how the Japanese deal with that a lot of the time. They don't ban it. Just everyone sort of unspokenly agrees to not use it.
Gentlemen's agreements.
Was it Osagat?
Yeah, Osagat.
Like, no one uses it because it's too powerful. Because if anyone used it, everybody would have to use it, because it's so overpoweredly broken.
They soft ban him, and I don't know how that is true. That works there. It doesn't work here.
Mentality, I think.
Oh yeah. So in my book, Playing to Win, and the articles on it, I talk about this concept that bans have to be discreet, enforceable, and warranted. That's kind of the criteria. So like discreet means you have to be able to fully explain what it is. like wrap, you know, a circle around it. Snaking, you can't do that. Like what is snaking and what's not? Like you can kind of barely snake, and so you can't really discreetly define it. Or if there's a certain combo, it was like five moves over and over in a fighting game, you can't really fully define that either, because you could sneak in, like instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you could do 1, 2, 3, 4, useless move 5. Does that count? What about, like, there's just so many little variations that you can't even put your finger on the thing that you're banning. So you've got to be able to do that. A good example would be a card. You can say that card is banned, and people know exactly what you mean. You can draw a circle around the card. Anything in is banned, everything out is not banned. It's very discreet and good. Same with a character. Don't pick this character. If you do, you know, you're disqualified. Enforceable is another one. Like, you can't, it's pretty hard to ban things that aren't enforceable.
A little.
Like, that have to do with hidden information or something. Like, I don't know, imagine a card game where there was a rule that's like, if you have, like, the lowest numbered card in your hand, you have to play it or something. But only you know the numbers of the cards. So you could go through several turns, like, just claiming you don't have it and no one would know. That's a terrible form of a rule. And then the other one is warranted. That's the one where everyone really tripped up, I think, is should you even ban it? Like, is it even powerful enough? Is there an actual reason to ban this thing? So you get into these like scrub arguments where there's something like barely good and that people want to ban that, you know, because they don't know how to deal with it. So the message I've tried to give is that probably 99% of the time someone wants to ban something for the reason of it being too good, they're probably wrong. I mean, I just hear wrong things like that all the time in tons of games. It doesn't mean they're wrong 100%. Once in a while, a thing really is too good and it really wrecks the whole game and it probably should be banned. So you got to have some wisdom to sort out the 1% from the 99 there.
So I throw out with everything you've just said, this follows up with what Turgut is asking. As a designer, not the player, but as the designer, okay. How do you tackle this in your games, if at all? Just how do you deal with it? Do you decide to keep it, fix it?
Yeah, so I definitely deal with it. There's unintended things in Yomi. Maybe I didn't mention some in that article or something, but like the worst thing for me as the designer is when the flavor of the character, like what they're supposed to be about, is totally trampled on by unintended dynamics or bugs or whatever. Like if Jaina is supposed to be the aggressive rushdown character, but really the best way to play her is to block all day and never do anything, then that's a problem. And yeah, we should, as a designer, I should fix that. It's not because it's too good. That's a separate issue. It's just wrong feeling. And I put way more emphasis on how things feel than even the balance. Like, I know I work on the balance a lot, but number one for me is that things got to feel right. The rock character has to feel like he's big and strong. The fast character has to actually be fast. And the reason that is so important to put in the center is that when you make the design for a character, here's your vision. It's a certain thing. But then it's not perfect. You've got to change this little bit for the balance and this little bit for the balance. And I think of it as like weeds that are growing around your original design. Those weeds better be growing around a thing that is coherent and makes sense. Because if you make like a rock guy that has way too few hit points and he's like a weakling or something, and that's your starting point, all those weeds are going to grow around that. And if you ever want to change it later, there's like tendrils of balance everywhere that are going to stop you. People are going to go, you can't give him more hit points. There's like this long list of 20 reasons why it would break the game. So that's why you got to get the feeling right in the first place and keep it right. And so all the little balance changes that solidify everything, you know, they're forcing you into a certain design. So the answer is, if there were bugs that were ruining the flavor of a character, I would absolutely change them immediately, regardless of what effect that had on the balance. And then I'd iterate to make the balance right. Get the core feeling right, and then change the balance. Now, a different one would be like, what if the bug was consistent with how the character, you know, their play style or something, but it just wasn't really meant to be that way? I don't necessarily object to that. That's more of like an accessibility issue. Like if it was really counterintuitive and bizarre, maybe we shouldn't have things like that. But it could be okay. It could be the kind of thing where you start to build around it and accept it as not a bug anymore. I mean, we need more specific examples, I guess, but it gives you some sense.
Mm, definitely. Sharp Object also adds, in reference to you talking about Warranted, it's really weird to see stuff like Wobbling or the Waldstein Infinite Band.
I know what that is, but I don't know enough about it to comment.
Okay, so no comment on that one.
I assume it makes reference to a specific fighting game or something like that.
I definitely believe it is. But yes. Okay. Go ahead, ask more questions. I need a drink real quick. On you.
Okay. Okay. This is one because this is one that fascinates me. And it's one that came up, and it's relevant to my Yummy playing as well. How do you deal when the thing that's too powerful in one matchup is the same thing that is too weak in another?
Well, that's,
and you've given a specific example of this one.
Yeah,
because
it's
he
the
was
Arg
go
counter,
there.
Where it's too strong against Lum but too weak against Gloria.
Well,
how did you work that one out?
I mean, the good news is that's super rare.
That is good news.
I mean, that example I gave was just so notable because of how hard it was to solve. Normally, it's not like that. A more common case is like a thing is too good in one matchup, but it's fine in the others. Yeah. And what do you do there? And so and then there's no general answer to that question. It depends on all the details. You got to be tricky and like look for a way to affect one matchup without ruining the others. Some like really easy ones of that in Street Fighter are like a DJ. He has this machine gun punch where he punches really fast, and I made it destroy fireballs. So right, it was just like obviously that doesn't affect matches with no fireballs, and it does affect matches with fireballs. And we like affecting matches with fireballs was the exact thing I wanted to do. So it perfectly lined up. You get lucky there. Or another one is like Dhalsim can punch really low to the ground and a really long stretchy arm and can hit Guile's Sonic Boom. That's just a general thing that Dhalsim can reach far and low. But the specific problem in that one match is that it reaches underneath the Sonic Boom. And he can hit Guile cleanly and have the Sonic Boom go over Dhalsim's head, and that just turns out to be too good. So how do you fix that one match without ruining everything else? Well, it turns out if you just make Dhalsim a little bit higher during that move, it affects basically nothing in the entire game. No character cares about his exact height while he's punching really far, except that Sonic Boom. That Sonic Boom cares. So that's a really fortunate thing where a detail is irrelevant everywhere except the one place we need to change it. The one you said is the crazy difficult one.
Crazy stupid. Okay.
Yeah, actually, remind me how that one went.
Okay, right. I'll sort of elaborate as well for the people who aren't so aware of Yomi. Okay. There is a character called Lum, and he's a gambling panda. His main thing is he likes to attack a lot. The problem is you've got a character called Agrigark. He likes to block a lot. Blocks beat attacks. This is a rather tough matchup for Lum. Lum, however, is a gambling panda, so he has other tricks, like making poker hands and playing blackjack with his deck that allow him to deal damage outside of combat. The problem is, Agrigarg has a counter, which makes this really, really tough for Lum, because the few things he can do outside of combat, Agrigarg just goes, nope, not doing them. However, on the other side, one of Agrigarg's toughest matchups is Gloria. The reason for this is Gloria heals, where Agrigarg has a constantly ticking damage aura. The problem is that anything Agrigarg counters, Gloria can recur from her graveyard back into her hand.
Yeah, so this counter sucks against her. Is the problem.
So the counter is terrible against Gloria, but too good against Lum in an already unbalanced matchup. So you have to simultaneously nerf the counter whilst buffing it against Gloria.
So to solve that took weeks to solve that, and it was like a known issue. You know, we know that's a problem, that it's the counter's too good here and it's too bad there. So what do we do? Like, I don't know what to do. And so I ask other people, like, well, what do you think we should do? And this is like kind of a, this, that could be a class right there or something in design, because when you get all these answers, they're, you know, the brainstorming answers are not, they're not always good, but there's a lot of reasons why you can just immediately dismiss various answers. Like they're too complicated. That's, most of them are just too damn complicated of a way to solve that. Or they ruin what the character's supposed to be about or something, or maybe they take a lot of words, or they require changing too many cards. There's just a lot of reasons why I can go, no, 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 no. And so people keep trying to answer. And I guess you start to see a pattern in the answers, maybe, like what they're trying to get to. Mm-hmm. You know, they're trying to get to, well, if the counter's bad against Gloria because she gets it right, like you counter the card, and then it goes to the discard pile, but she can get things from the discard pile, so it kind of didn't even stop her. They're all the suggestions are pointing at, don't let her get it back somehow. Don't put it in a place where she can get it. Right? So, okay, that's promising, because when you counter that move, if you put it somewhere far away where she can't get it, most people wouldn't care. It's kind of like the Guile Dulcim thing again. It's like most characters don't really care what happens when it's countered, because they can't get it anyway. So if we could put it in a special place where Gloria can't get it, that could help. That doesn't really tell you why Lum is happy, though.
Yeah.
So then you've got to go like, well, is there somewhere we can put it where Lum can get it, but no one else can get it? Huh? That would be magic if that worked. And we eventually did it, and it's kind of convoluted, but whatever. Like, you know, when does it go to the bottom?
It now goes to the bottom of the deck.
Yeah,
because Lum can just power up and reshuffle his deck at any time, and then you added something where occasionally he can just draw from the bottom of his... He just cheats and draws from the bottom of his deck.
Yeah, he can occasionally draw it from the bottom, and he can also just... He draws a lot of cards, so he can potentially just
constantly reshuffle his deck, yeah.
Yeah, and so how much does that really help him? Like, a fair amount. Maybe not. Maybe it would have been nice if it helped him even more, but that's so delicate that that's not even going to get any better, really.
Yeah, it's still a tough matchup for Lum, but now having his stuff countered doesn't kill him completely.
Right. I mean,
he can now get it back.
It's into the acceptable range, whereas it wasn't before. People were saying it was
like
the
8-2?
Most
wasn't it like an 8-2?
Yeah,
at one point, because it's just attacks going into blocks, and then anything else he could do just gets crash and flowed.
And for some perspective, 8-2 is like a normal thing in fighting games, but we try to have a high standard here.
Yeah. Like, I don't think you've even got a single 7-3 by current consensus. The worst is 6.5.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's based on the latest one.
Let me pull the matchup chart. I think the worst one is some six. You've got some 6-5, 3-5s.
Yeah, there's like.
Oh, yeah, one of them being Gloria versus Arg.
Yeah, that's right.
Hey, the answer is there in the cards.
Yeah.
Right.
6-5, 3. Yeah, 6-5, 3-5 is the worst you've got, which is Lum Arg and Gloria Arg.
Oh, that's pretty amazing. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, there's a theme.
It took a while for you to get to where you're at today, I'll tell you that, from what you've stated. Only been working on the game for a while.
I didn't even think, as a designer, like, I didn't think of doing this level of balance until a lot of the way through Street Fighter. Like, my first just instinct of way to approach balancing Street Fighter was Super Turbo Street Fighter, the game that came before the one I worked on. We had like 14 years of tournaments of that, and we know exactly, like, it hadn't changed at all. We know exactly what is good and what is not. So let's take the things that are not good and boost them. Take the things that are good and just barely nerf them. And then everything will be closer. So I thought of it in terms of a tier list. Like, if you list how good are the best character, you know, which characters are the best, which are the second best. I wanted those tiers to be closer, more compressed. That was kind of the extent of my thinking. But then in the middle of the project, some of the players were complaining about, well, what about this one specific matchup? Like, I'm not complaining that this character is overall too weak. They're mid, which is fine, but there's just one matchup that sucks, and shouldn't that not be in the game? And I was like, oh, yeah, you know, you're really right. It really shouldn't be, ideally. So I guess we should look at the entire matchup chart and look for every matchup in the game that is 8-2 or whatever, even if the tier list is pretty compressed. So that was like a phase two of balancing. And so I treated Yomi the same way, where at first we only really care about which are the best characters, which are mid, which are terrible, and try to compress those. And then once they're all kind of close, then look at the matchup chart and see the particular matchup problems that could be hiding there. I mean, you can imagine some character that only has 8-2 and 2-8 matchup, 8-2 or 2-8. Like, every single matchup they have is terrible to play, but they have an equal number of both, so they're like mid-tier. So, you know, the tier list can hide that problem, but the matchup chart shows the problem. So that was the next phase, is like, look at the matchup chart, and then there's just these terrible matchups that everyone's going to complain about, and the community zeroes in on those really quickly. Like, I don't have to think about 210 matchups, because right away, everyone only cares about like five of them or something that are busted.
Like, everyone was screaming about
Lamar. Yeah, it's like the only ones anyone talks about are these five or something. And then you fix those five, and sometimes I don't mean that your change fucks up another one, but just because the spotlight is off that, now people like search the matchups more, and they identify a new one that they weren't looking at before. They find a new problem. So you got to keep lopping off all the sharp edges, and then let it stew. Let the stew cook for a while, and see if any more problems surface.
So what you're talking about with your matchup charts is player or character v character in the non-mirror method. What happens in the situation where you have 2v2, and you have multiple players, multiple characters? Did you consider those, or do you just kind of rely on the one-on-one to help you figure out the best way to get to the type of closeness and the tiering that you're after?
So I have not, of all the, I've worked on many games with the need balance stuff, but I haven't worked on any that have a 2v2 mode where that is a big spotlight of the game and intended to be super balanced. So Yomi has a 2v2 mode, but it's like an extra thing or something. And here's what I can say about the balance of that mode, is that if you pick almost just at random any two characters, and then think through, like, what would they do on a team in the 2v2 mode? Like, what unfair synergy do they have? You seem to find something pretty crazy powerful. And so I don't know the ultimate balance of the game, of the 2v2 mode, but I know that no matter who you pick, there's some kind of nonsense.
There's some kind of craziness. And then leverage. On top of that, you can never go through the matchup chart for it, because once you get into 2v2, it's something like 14,000 different matchups or something like that.
I don't know if you're familiar with Marvel vs. Capcom 2, but that's like the kind of balancing they have, where they just threw a bunch of crazy stuff into the game, and you pick it's a 1v1 game, but you pick a team of three characters, and the team, like, who knows what nonsense was going to come out of those teams? They didn't know. Teams were like, new crazy teams came out all the time. I mean, that came out, I mean, like, by the players. Like, the players would discover these synergies. And it's like, everything is so broken that it's fair was kind of the way.
Yeah, it's balance and absurdity, because everything is broken.
There's an end
to
that. That's not forever, right? I mean, there's a long period where you explore, you know, everything seems broken and kind of equal to each other. But at the end of the day, after years and years and years, something is going to be the best. And that is true of Marvel vs. Capcom 2. It collapsed to very, very few things working. Now, for Yomi 2v2 mode, it's like, it's not played seriously competitively. I wonder if we will ever reach that settle down point, you know? Like, that only matters for a hyper-competitive scene.
Yeah, it does. And I think as well, because I think the characters and the tiers are so compressed, I think it stands at least a reasonable chance of it being fairly even. Because no character is really objectively garbage.
Yeah, so, I mean, you could...
BBB gets a bit close at times.
What if I totally cared about that mode? Like, then what?
Yeah, that, yeah.
That would be pretty hard.
That would just add another couple years to your life. That's okay.
There's too many matchups we've considered. Yeah, then
you get a whole new set of problems of, like, you know, these two characters are actually completely fine, but we're in their own team with each other.
they're completely off the chart.
Sounds difficult.
Okay. So we don't end up keeping you forever and a day. What I'm going to do is I'm going to just let some people know about the game jam that we have coming up. And then what I would like for you, David, to do is to give just any quick little tips that you can think of that someone might want to keep in mind when they're trying to work on a way to not necessarily give the players what they want, but what they need to ensure that a game remains fun and in its own right balance, because every game has its own different balance that you're going to be looking at. So, I mean, RTSs are different than MMOs, are different than, you know, an RPG, or different than a third person shooter, or there's different things for, but anything that you might be able to give quick tip advice wise. So think on that for a second. Yeah. And for everyone who is interested in getting involved in what we have coming up, which is a charity game jam in December. We're going to be working our butts off for 48 hours live on Twitch. We have several teams coming up. We are looking to have 10 teams in total. We have a couple of developers already in charge of some teams, and we also have Healing Over Time, the charity group that we're working with, who are going to be, I believe, looking at Operation Supply Drop as well as Child's Play for our charity. But if you want to get involved, pay attention to our site, December 12th through the 14th, for 48 hours, live streamed on Twitch. We're going to do a game jam, and then the games at the end, and their prototyped and finished format to the best that they can get it in that 48-hour times, will be put up available on Itch.io for people to buy for charity. If you're interested in that, get in touch with us, voice@mmobuff.tv. Do be aware, though, that if you come to me and say you just want to be an ideas person, there's not a team for you. If you are a developer, show us a little bit of the work you do on the engines. If you are an artist, show us a little bit of the art you do. If you're a sound musician, get in touch with us and show us some of the sound that you create. In the end, you have until December to get your hands dirty in these applications. Do so that we can put you into a fun team and hopefully give you amazing prizes. We're giving away so much stuff, it's not even funny. So that's our game jam. All I wanted to say on that. Now back to David for advice.
Advice on how to balance things?
Tips to help people, because the biggest thing I'm walking away from this, because I am working on a tabletop RPG, and the biggest thing that I'm walking away from is screw the metrics for the moment. Let people play. Get the feeling from them, and are we actually getting it just right? Or are we kind of going way too left field or way too right field? Try and get the feeling and work with it there, and then turn to experts. And the only way you can get experts is by letting people play the game.
Yeah, so, I think we've covered that quite a bit. So my
exactly.
advice be maybe a different set of stuff. Everything we've talked about is kind of like, if you have a thing, what do you do with it to inch it towards being more balanced? But here's my advice is, before you even have a thing, you should probably make a thing that is balanceable at all. Okay?
Okay.
You can go way wrong at just minute one. So try to have some inherent counters to things. Like in Yomi, there's attack, block, throw, and dodge. And they have a paper, rock, scissors, you know, relationship with each other. Or even in StarCraft, like, there's flying things, but there's anti-air to hit flying. Like, there's things can beat other things. Keep that in mind. Is whenever your core system is like what beats what, and to make sure that you've got everything covered, or else you might just be hopeless later. The other thing would be how many things are you trying to balance? You have 10 characters, 20 characters. Okay, think about it, instead of 10 or 20 characters, if you are trying to balance 100 million decks, like literally 100 million decks. That's too many decks. You can't, if you have 100 million decks, how is one of them not going to be the best? There's just some broken thing that's going to be unbeatable. And then if you, let's say you banned that or you took that out of the game, do you really think that after that's gone, that the 20 top decks remaining are all equal power to each other out of the 100 million? There's no way. There's no way. There's going to be one, you know, that's left. There's one or two. You're never going to get like 20 equally top decks out of 100 million. So when you have customization that is just out of control and huge, that's a problem you run into, and it's kind of intractable. So there's an irony that if you take away customization and only have 20 options, you could have 20 really good balanced options, where if you give the player the illusion of 100 million options, maybe only one is any good. So think about limiting customization and think about what beats what, and set yourself up for success of something that is achievable balance-wise.
So basically what you're telling us is Yomi is not just going to have 1v1, you're also going to support 2v2 and in the future 4v4, right?
Yeah, right. And why stop at 20 characters? Why not have 100 characters and have you be able to mix all their cards to do anything you want? And then everything.
I mean, come on, you already have 20. Why not add 20 more? That's not a big deal, right?
Exactly. See, I'm now expecting to see some kind of crazy mode for Yomi in a tournament where it's, you know, throw the decks, everyone brings their decks, throws them out, mixes them up, and you grab equal cards, and you're stuck with what you get.
Yeah, some of the players have speculated, what if you could just make any deck of Yomi, like you just mix all the decks, like how many good decks are there? And there's some debate over whether there's only one or two. I think there's only one.
Like, out of curiosity, which one?
I don't remember.
Probably,
but
some,
I think,
hybrid of Graven.
If you ask your chat, someone in there will have
probably some weird mix of Graven Minelka.
Yeah, Minelka's ability to fetch black face cards is probably somewhere.
Drosophony.
What's that?
Trosophony. You know what it is? It's going on 1 a.m. from it's past 1 a.m.
Some hybrid of Troc and Persephone. I can see that being
sharp probably. Object brings that one up. So
yeah,
custom clockwork Yomi.
Yeah, it is a Persephone with Jaina 7 and Troc 10.
You know,
Diablo
is facing that problem right now. I've been following their balance, and the good news on their part is that it seems like with the top leaderboards of each class, like, the classes are pretty close to each other. So you're like, oh, okay, so it's kind of balanced. Oh, but unfortunately, every single class has only one build that works. And out of the trillions of builds possible, well, you really only got one choice at the top end. I don't even know what to tell them to do. Like,
for Diablo 3?
Yeah, like, if they were unsatisfied that there's only one build and they wanted there to be 50 builds that were viable, like, I don't even, what could I even tell them?
I have friends that are constantly complaining about Diablo 3 because they were so hyped, and in the end you just have only one build for one character and that's about it. Anything else is just, you know, not viable to play, and that kills all the fun.
Do you have any ideas? Do you know
I don't even know. Like, honestly, I don't even.
Yes.
See, that's. I think this is where
the messed up system.
This is where I like what you're saying, at least for advice wise, because, you know, when it comes down to it, if you try to give so many options out there and yet there's really only one thing viable, why did you give the rest of the options out there to begin with? It's one of the problems I have with a lot of MMOs. It's a problem that I have with even some TCGs. I can understand how metas work and things like that, but I can get really frustrated if there's only one deck that is viable if you have these cards.
Josie, you know? Can I be cynical? Why Diablo 3 gave all the options? Because that, come on, that,
okay.
This
okay.
Action house, this money's. Come on, I mean, come on.
All right, okay. It's all about the money, apparently, and, you know, yeah.
I mean, obviously, you can, like, real money action house in Diablo 4. Oh, Jesus, I probably woke up neighbors. You have real life action house in the game. I mean, thankfully, like, they disabled it, but still, what else would be the option? Like, they had to skew entire game balance towards the idea that players will come with cash and they will be selling money, and then you will have people farming a lot of items so they can sell them for money to those people that are buying those. Like, there is no way it will not affect your game balance, especially if you're taking 15% cut from it, from
I
each
do have
transaction.
One answer in the card world, and I had to answer the same question for my customizable card game Codex. I've been working on that for over 10 years, literally. It works like opposite of any customizable card game you've seen. But that same problem came up. So I have, if you can make 100 million or trillion decks or something, how is it ever going to work? And what I noticed, I started by just not even solving that. I'm like, I'm just not even going to think about that. We're just going to keep going. And then I would build decks to play where it's not a problem when I build it. You know, it's a problem if I let you build anything you want. And then I started realizing, like, well, why am I letting you build anything you want if all that does is cause problems? So instead, the way my game works is there's actually preset chunks, and you can put those chunks together however you want, but I know that you at least have full chunks, and each chunk that goes into these decks is like a coherent thing that works and does what it's supposed to do. So if you mix together a bunch of chunks, there's kind of like a minimum of how bad your deck could possibly be, because you at least, I mean, I know that you have access
to certain
tools. Like, you can't avoid having access to certain tools.
I would go counter it then, because that's exactly what they did in Guild Wars 2. I don't know how you followed the game. In Guild Wars 1, you had 10 abilities, and you could pick any ability whatsoever, and you could make pretty fucked up build. Like, you could make pretty horrible build, and you would purposefully screw up yourself so hard. So in Guild Wars 2, they try to get away with the holy trinity of healer, tank, and DPS, and they gave healing ability to everyone, and you had to pick healing ability. And then they made it so your first 5 abilities are affected by the weapon you have, and you cannot change them at all. So you can only customize like 4 last abilities, to be honest, because like the healing was only 3. And what ends up happening is that the game is pretty boring and lacking. Like, I had way more fun doing crazy builds in Guild Wars 1 than I had playing Guild Wars 2, even though I find combat more enjoyable. But everything else from the game, it's just so boring, because, like, I'm playing the same character over and over again, no matter what choices I'm... Like, I'm so limited within the pool of the choices that I have that everything feels samey, so I ended up, like, quitting the game.
It's finding the balance between the two. Because, like you say, you've got to have these chunks, but those chunks are customizable. Whereas Guild Wars has, you've got to have this, and you've got to have these, and in the end, only this is actually customizable. So it's all this chunk that isn't customizable at all. Whereas the way David's done it for Codex,
way more restrictive than even I am.
It's even way more.
Yeah. I mean, the way Codex is working is you've got this chunk of the deck and this chunk of the deck. Can be then built out of these things, but it's still built how you want to within that restriction. Mm-hmm. And then
so
that adds to
still
this
more like
sections.
Guild Wars 1.
Yeah, so you've got this section and this section and this section, and those are all customized within certain rules, and then they go together to form your overall deck.
I want to bring this this comment up from chat, mainly because I have a feeling, David, you have an opinion on this.
Well, great.
So, Dr. Articuna says, well, even with game balance, you're going to have things that are off meta, or cheese, that are strong in situations. Look at League of Legends, for example. They have 120 champions, and only 10 to 18 champions are played consistently in the pro scene. But every once in a while, you have an off pick that works. So in games that have a lot of options, and only a few that work, keep in mind that all of them work. It's just in what situation.
Well that's about breaking the meta.
Explanation of that. I mean,
couldn't hear you there.
They don't all work by the statement of the problem. The problem said that there's 100 heroes and only 20 are used. And then concluded.
I think I know what they're saying. So let's say let's have a situation League of Legends when your meta is that you have a lot of hard engaged champions, the champions that are jumping in, tossing really hard crowd control like stun, like fear, stuff like that, and then you know, this sort of meta emerge, and then champion that previously wasn't played, Morgana, became very playable before people noticed it, and that's because of one ability of hers, which was shield that blocks all of the hard CC. So the champion wasn't viable before, but when this meta became the standard of this, you know, hard CC, then the champion became viable. But that's because of the player choices and like.
Yeah. Okay. You know. Okay. So you've got 100 characters, and 80 of them are not viable, but any one of those 80 might be, depending on how the metagame shifts.
Exactly.
So then you sort of define that they're all okay. That's a really low standard of balance to have. That's like, why accept something? So there's problems within problems in that whole thing.
Yeah.
Another one is that The statement of the problem was that there, how many were viable? 18 or 20, did it say?
18, yeah, 10
to 18. 18.
10 to 18. I would say like 18, 20, more like that, but no.
Yeah.
So 10 to 18, whatever. Okay, so one objection might be, well, that's a pretty low number. But then a separate objection is that how many are viable without a band system, and why is there a band system? And that's,
oh,
more,
yeah.
That's a terrible Band-Aid. It's like giving up before you start. I mean, why do you have a band system? The answer is because you can't have a game that works with that many characters. So yeah. You really shouldn't. You just shouldn't have that many characters.
So it would make more sense to limit the amount of characters, put more focus on how those characters interact with each other, and make a game that's richer because of it.
Yeah, I'm super against this band system stuff because of the very first thing you asked me when we sat down at the beginning of this interview, and you said, why do I like asymmetric games? Well, it's because I can pick a character that matches my personality and like the story and look of that character and the way that they play. There's something about how they work that matches up with what I want to do. And that's the promise that the asymmetric game gives to the player, is the promise that you can like find your match and devote yourself to it. And that's totally undercut and the rug pulled out from underneath you when some system says, oh, now you can't play that character. Like, what? Really? I personally wouldn't play the game if it's going to be that way.
See,
so,
that makes me think about how Heroes of the Storm is going to turn out, because they have a limited set of characters, and maybe they'll put more time into figuring out the balance, and maybe they've got more brains and more people to do the work for them. So because, it, you know, it's not 20, I think it's a lot more than 20.
They're like 40, I think. I don't know.
I can't remember. I see the screen in my head, but I can't remember the number.
The other thing about Heroes of the Storm is that it's a lot more objective focused. Like, you can actually win games just by taking objectives and avoiding teamfights altogether. So you sort of can avoid interacting with opposing team. I mean, as long as you're smart about it and the opposite team is dumb enough. But, you know, still viable.
Well, maybe not interacting is a bad dynamic or something, but yeah, that
yeah,
would give
yeah,
it more was... leeway in the balance. There'd be a less of a razor thin thing going on.
Yeah, because I mean, the ban system also gets ridiculous, because you then just see things like what happened in the recent sort of big Dota tournaments, where it's the same characters over and over and over and over and over, just constantly getting banned out.
Yeah.
It's just such an alien thing to me. Like, I can't even imagine going to a Street Fighter tournament and, like, knowing that, oh, this Blanka player, he's the best Blanka player in the world. He's so good that we're never going to get to see him play Blanka ever. Like, it's, what? Really? That's how this works? Like,
he retracted his statement. Yeah. It's not 10 to 18. It's 40 to 70 out of 120 characters.
Played worldwide. However,
with bans,
that's A, with bans, and B, that's worldwide across all the different metas in all the different regions. Probably in North America, for example, that meta is distilled down to about 10 to 18 championships.
I think when you take a look at statistics and you take like from prominent tournaments, like, I know, LCS or something like that, you see like around 20, 25 characters total played. Like, really not a lot. Yeah. I mean, like, more than once. Because, you know, sometimes someone will make a troll pick, or, like, you know, for the lulz will go with different approach. But, like, characters that are actually played by teams is, like, very small number on the high ceiling.
Well, in their defense, the stats are a little tricky, because, like, if you looked at the stats for Yomi, you might say that Gloria was not pickable or something, because no one's good at her. But she is. That would be a trick.
She's very
stats.
Strong.
There's a little bit of that going on, but what there's what there's much more of going on is that they're basically, the company is paid by the character. And it's like Charles Dickens paid the bird or something. It's like not surprising what you end up with.
I mean, we go back to the old, you know, talking about real money action house. Like, once you mingle money, real money, with your game mechanics, then your balance and your strategy of anything, game design, just goes off the roof. Because, hey, money, right?
Yeah, so you end up with more characters than are really tractable, and now you've got like dozens that you can't even pick. Like, they have cool art and cool style, but no one can really play them. Except once in a blue moon when the meta shifts.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you end up with characters that are just straight out better, you know, power creep, because you want people to keep buying characters.
Well, it's all about the money, as we discussed earlier.
It's a different world.
Yeah.
Target says 99% of the time you cannot play the hero you like. Oh, and you have to be able to play many different characters at a high level, because if you focus on one or two, they will be banned.
Yeah, because ban system.
It's such a weird... It does seem sort of like this really nasty Band-Aid. It's like super glue instead of Band-Aid.
Yeah, it's... I can't even communicate to you how distasteful it is to me. Like, I just keep thinking of that Street Fighter example where the person who's so good at their character and you can't see it. Like, it's you'd hope that the highest level tournament is a showcase of the best skills in the world. And you don't get that when you ban all the best characters of each player.
Do you want something even sadder? Like, when I started playing League of Legends, I really like character Rani. Like, that was basically the only character that I played. 140 games within the first couple of months. Like, insane amount of, okay. Like, I was really good with her. And then another character came, new one, I honestly don't remember, honest to God, which was basically Annie, but straight up better. Like, better everything. How and cool. I was like, yeah, guys, why you do this to me? Why you kill my soul? And I ended up just like completely abandoning mages, and I like switched to completely different role and just like screw with this. Wow. Role, like, you know, fuck this, fuck that. I'm out.
I'll give another public service announcement that I boycott League of Legends, but not for any of these reasons. I mean, the only reason is that it has a forced grind, which has no place in a competitive game. It would be absurd if you wanted to play chess and they're like, oh, you can't have all the pieces. You gotta play 100 hours before you get all the pieces. Or
you start with pawns only.
You can't have like Ryu's jump fierce or a sweep yet. You gotta play. It's like, that's not okay. That's way not okay. Anyone that is like serious about competition, their stomach should churn at that. And I can't. Yeah. I won't even touch any game that does that.
That's actually one of the things I was quite interested to see with Blizzard, because they'd had. They've been trying to find a balance between with Heroes of the Storm of not overloading you, so you get introduced to things gradually, but not making that so long that you've got to play like 50 games before you've got all your stuff. They've just just recently compressed the distance.
I haven't played it, but my friend was telling me about it, and his opinion was that the grind to go from, you know, nothing to everything. In his opinion, it felt like the new player experience tacked on at the beginning of a game, as opposed to leveling to max in World of Warcraft or something, which is how it feels.
Something that I would say in defense of leveling system, though, it actually the interesting offshoot of it is that it attaches time value to your account. So if you're gonna get banned, it actually stinks a lot more. Like, because, you know, League of Legends is a free-to-play game, so you can make a free account, whatever. But because you have to level up your account, it adds time value. So it actually curbs down all the misbehavior and flaming and, you know, people that are generally behaving like assholes, because they will
Let's be honest. No, it doesn't. This is League of Legends. It's got a reputation for a reason.
Well, okay, honestly, it's bad, but it used to be a lot worse at the start. Yeah. And now that I'm, you know, now that I'm 30 and I never play with new accounts again, I honestly don't have that many stupid people. So
I can see the logic behind that. Yeah,
I think I think it doesn't. So there's some disconnect of logic there. Actually, it's like that argument, even if that's correct. It doesn't follow that you need to stop me from buying a full account. Right?
Hmm. Point.
Like, yeah. So, but that's the problem right there, is that
that's
a forced grind. There is no way to just buy the game. Like, I can buy Street Fighter and have all of it, but I can only buy shitty, or not even buy. I can't even buy it. They won't sell it to me.
You cannot buy account here.
I can only play GIMPed League of Legends. And when you think of it in other genres, it's just so mind-blowingly bad. Like, but why is it okay in that genre? My answer is there's really nothing different about the chess example, the Street Fighter example, or the League of Legends example. There's nothing materially different that excuses it in one genre.
Yeah. I mean, it would excuse it if it wouldn't be PvP, you know, nationals game. Because, you know, you have it in World of Warcraft. You have it in World of Warcraft, which is PvE game. And then
if it's a PvE game, it's like the journey is the experience. It's not like... In a PvE game, it's not like the real game starts once you unlock everything, but that is exactly the case in a multiplayer game, where it is that the real game starts when you unlock it.
Yes, so, you have a point, yes.
Yeah.
I just want to make a point about the toxicity of the League of Legends player base and generally any mobile player base. It basically arises from the game design, because it's a game when you're so reliant on your teammates, and often on clutch team battles, is that one person screwing up one thing at one time and instantly 40 minutes of your life just puff gone, like wasted time. So that's another thing which is like, from the game design standpoint, it's very jarring for me.
I understand your point very well. And it's like in most competitive games, if you have a player in your team who's bad, that's kind of similar to them not being there. Like, if they're bad. But it's not the same in World in League
it's actively detrimental, because they are feeding experience and goals.
Exactly, they're feeding. So you'd much rather they just do nothing and disappear or something than be bad. And that leads to everyone hating each other.
Well, see, that's the thing. You know, what you're talking about is, you know, what you've just said is you're played for 40 minutes and one person made one mistake. And that is unforgiving to the point where people need to turn around and call each other names in a massively toxic manner and have hatred. I'm sorry, nobody's a perfect player. Nobody is perfect. You know, to me, it doesn't excuse that kind of toxicity in a community. I appreciate competition, believe me. But if a game design has it so one person makes one mistake in 40 minutes and everything has gone to shit, there needs to be some way to get back or to recover or something, you know?
That's a great bad game design, and also one of the reasons why I dislike MOBAs, because they're snowball games.
They're too
badly snowball games.
It's not just this one mistake, though. I mean, he's adding another nuance there, because you could play a game of basketball, and then someone could miss their three-point shot at the end, and that shot, that one mistake of missing the shot, could cause you to lose. But that's not nearly
You're not going to turn around and deck the guy because he missed the three-pointer, are you?
Well, that's also common.
You shouldn't do that.
But his point is that this is not analogous to that. It's way worse than that. It's that, you know, they're feeding and actually helping the enemy, and so
it's like when you miss your 3-point.
It's just explaining. It's like that's why there's so much toxicity.
Yeah. A better argument would be if the player misses their 3-point shot, the other team gets 3 points instead.
Yeah.
Right. That'd be the analogy.
Stop shooting. Just don't take any shots. Yeah.
It'll be like, instead of shooting your three-pointer, you're passing up to enemy player that's ready for their three-pointer.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a really good analogy for that.
Yeah, so can you imagine if we designed that basketball game, like a new type of basketball where when you miss the three-point shot, like the whole game stops and you just let the opponent have a three-point shot? And then what kind of team friendliness would you get?
Oh, a lot of broken legs, broken arms, people poisoning people's Gatorade or something.
A horrible, horrible, toxic mess.
Right. I mean, it's foreseeable, right? We didn't even have to make the basketball game. We already know what it's going to be like.
Yeah. Oh, man. Okay. Well, I have kept you for an incredibly long time. I want to say thank you so much for coming on and chatting with us about literally all kinds of things. Everything from Yomi to League of Legends. Heck, we tapped into StarCraft. We've even discussed Diablo. We've talked about card games of a variety amount. And my goodness, I have learned a hell of a lot, especially considering the fact that it's nice to know that sometimes developers need to not look at the metrics and just go with the gut, because sometimes the gut has got it. So I kind of really, really, really appreciate that. But to all of you guys who are watching, thank you for your questions. Thank you for your comments. Thank you for everything that you have brought forth. It's amazing to sit here and watch a discussion. I get to listen to a discussion and participate, but I get to also watch really intelligent people discuss in a critical but not horribly toxic manner differing ideas and opinions, and I absolutely love that. So thank you guys so much for watching. Do you have anything you want to sign off with?
Oh, I don't know. Check out my newly relaunched website at Serlin.net, and if you were part of the Yomi Kickstarter, we'll get that to you as soon as we can. And my
next
game will be Codex, which is a totally different type of customizable card game than you've ever seen, so look for that.
You can get online. There's online versions of all of Serlin games at Fantasy Strike.
You can play Yomi Puzzle Strike or Flash Duel at fantasystrike.com. We don't have Pandante there yet, and Codex is not out yet, but the other three are all free to try.
Yep, and we recommend you go forth, play, cause problems. When you find something that's tiny and insignificant, complain about it as much as you possibly can. No,
yeah,
don't.
Then you'll blend right in.
But on that note, it leaves me to say, Peter, thank you so much for showing up. Patrick, thank you so much for staying up way too late. I'm sure you've probably woken somebody up with a debate, and I'm really sorry about that. And David, it has been an absolute honor and treat to have you here. I am Sudo. Thank you so much for tuning into MMO Buffs Datamine Special Edition, our indie show for indie devs with lots of people who seem to be more knowledgeable than I am. Wow. And on that note, toodle-pip, guys.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye. Thank you.